Ladies and gentlemen, it is my great privilege to introduce Margery Evans, CEO of the Australian Institute for Teaching and School Leadership.
Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you very much, Summer. What a great way to start our summit. Thank you, Dave and Summer, for that. And what an amazing thought. 3,051 years of teaching practice, collective expertise in the room. So as Chief Executive of AITSL, the Australian Institute for Teaching and School Leadership, it is a pleasure and an honour to welcome you on behalf of the AITSL Board of Directors and my AITSL colleagues to the inaugural Highly Accomplished and Lead Teacher Summit. I wish to acknowledge the Kaurna Nation, traditional custodians of the land on which we're gathered today, and pay my respects to Elders past, present and future, and acknowledge the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people who continue to contribute to our work to improve teaching and school leadership. I'd also like to acknowledge and thank the Minister for Education and Training, the Honourable Simon Birmingham, for joining us, and look forward to hearing from him shortly. I'd also like to acknowledge the AITSL Board Director Tanya Asplin and Dom Thurborn, who we'll also hear from later, representatives from certifying authorities across Australia, guests from Queensland, Victorian and Commonwealth departments, school leaders, and most importantly, highly accomplished and lead teachers in the room today. We thank you for making time in your busy schedules and giving up what is part of a long weekend for many of you, perhaps even missing Year 5 maths. When I started in my role as CEO of AITSL almost 6 years ago, I imagined what it might be like to bring together the very best teachers from right across Australia to engage in a dialogue focused on improving teacher quality. More recently, AITSL's chair, Professor John Hattie, who you'll meet and work with tomorrow, has placed a spotlight on expert teaching, and so here we are today. One of the things that I think is most amazing about the collection of these people is that we sent you one letter of invitation, sometimes that came through your regulatory authority, and without any further promotion, over half of all nationally certified teachers have come in one room, you've paid for yourself to be here, you've given up your Friday and your Saturday, as I said, often on a long weekend. I think that's an amazing tribute to both your energy and commitment, but to what we might potentially do together. And so we'll see the official launch of the Highly Accomplished and Lead Network, a network which will create opportunities to recognise as well as learn from and leverage the collective expertise of the best teacher practitioners in this country. The expertise and potential that sits in front of me, I think, is both humbling and exciting. The summit, with its themes of celebrate, commit, collaborate and champion, and the four summit goals, is designed to tap into this expertise, to challenge, to learn, and to seek ways and commitment to realise the potential of the network. So where did it all begin? Well, in 2010, AITSL led the work to develop the Australian Professional Standards for Teachers. The aim was to articulate quality professional practice at four distinct career stages so that that would be used to support teachers across Australia to reflect and improve on their practice. The risk is, as is the case with all forms of standards, that what would happen is that these standards would simply be seen as sort of a bit of a compliance exercise. Well, as nationally certified teachers, you've demonstrated the intent of the standards. You have voluntarily elected to take up a challenging process to evidence your practice against either highly accomplished or lead career stages, and you've voluntarily aspired to be masters of your craft and within your profession, and to test and improve your practice. So I don't want in any way to suggest that expert practice is not happening outside national certification, and there were and continue to be alternative processes in place in some jurisdictions to recognise high levels of expertise in the profession. But through the rigour of the national certification process, and I'm sure you will attest to the fact that it is rigorous, you have demonstrated your impact on students and colleagues. And perhaps, and indeed we hope, with every professional conversation that you have, every little bit extra that you give, you're contributing to writing a new narrative for our profession, that expertise matters. And that's what is at the heart of this new network. So the network, more specifically, in the summit over the next day and a half, is designed to identify and seek ways to maximise and share your expertise. In the politics of collaborative expertise, John Hattie draws attention to the difference between experienced teachers and expert teachers, and argues that we need communities aimed at improving teacher effectiveness and expertise. I know that most of you, in fact probably all of you, are already members of various professional communities, of networks and associations, and you might be wondering, why are we bringing you all together as a national network? That's a fair question, and I think the summit goals provide some very good answers. What I think is a much more interesting question is what can happen when a group of expert professionals work together. So when we were doing the preliminary thinking about the network, we came across Paul Percy Harris, long since dead, a lawyer in Chicago in the early 20th century, who together with three of his clients established the first Rotary Club. So the initial goal of those four men was to create a network of business professionals for friendship and fellowship. However, from the very first project, which happened to be constructing public toilets in Chicago, through a myriad of other achievements, including the creation of the Apprenticeship Commission in Melbourne, members have really been driven to excel and multiply. So now there are 35,000 Rotary Clubs across the world with 1.2 million members. The National Board of Professional Teaching Standards in the US gives us another example of what could happen. The National Board has been certifying the best of US teaching profession for 25 years. From 84 teachers in 1994, they now have over 110,000 board certified teachers across the states. Actually, and coincidentally, on this very same 2 days, the board are hosting their own annual and 10th teaching and learning conference in Washington, where about 5,000 certified teachers and other non-certified colleagues will gather to hear from each other and share expertise. And so we are, in fact, going to hear from them sometime later in the conference. One of the other key learnings from board experience, from that board experience, US board experience, is on the impact of certified teachers. And while we don't yet have the evidence base of our US colleagues, although at AITSL we're really exploring how we might look at undertaking or evaluating the longitudinal impact of nationally certified teaching. The findings from US are very encouraging. According to independent research by Corwin and Holber in 2015, the Centre for Education Data and Research, and I quote, "Certified teachers are more effective than non-certified teacher with similar experience. For example, they estimate that this could equate to, for example, additional learning gains equivalent about 5 weeks in middle school maths." Much more work to be done in this space, but I think the evidence is really clear. Certified teachers make a huge difference. So in the US, placing the acronym NBCT, or Nationally Board Certified Teacher, after your name is a mark of distinction, recognised by employers and school leaders and the public as an indication of expertise. So why shouldn't national certification have the same recognition here? Why wouldn't we want to see the profession recognise and support expert practice? Over the next day and a half, we'll work together to draw these learnings, the experience of others, to explore the shape and potential of this new national network, a network of nationally certified teachers working together, working smarter, to leverage those 3,051 years of practice and magnify your impact. So to help us think about and shape our own Aussie ambitions, we sought the input from a small group of your colleagues. Some are referred to that earlier, who formed the HALT Steering Group. And we're going to hear more about that from them this afternoon. But I did want to draw your attention to the draft charter or call for action they've developed. And that talks about raising the profile of and monitoring the value of certification, increasing the number of nationally certified teachers, supporting induction of beginning teachers to the profession, and showcase and sharing high quality teaching to inspire other teachers to progress to the highly accomplished and lead levels. We'll refine this over the next coming days and, you know, potentially years. But to each of the people that were involved in the steering group, thank you for laying the foundation and your contribution and vision. So to truly have an impact at a national level, and who knows, perhaps one day at an international level, like Harris and his early Rotary colleagues, we'll need to grow. And it's for this reason that an important focus of the network and the summit is to promote and raise the status of national certification. In Australia, there are 284 nationally certified teachers, as I said, half of whom are here in this room. That's an admirable start. But if we just consider for a moment, if every one of you, including those not with us today, were to mentor one colleague through the certification process over the next 12 months, in roughly a year to 18 months, there'd be around 550 certified teachers. Now imagine if we could gather together again in 2017 with double our numbers, and if we continued on this ambitious and yet I think very plausible trajectory, particularly when teamed with the tremendous effort that the certifying authorities are putting into certification, within next 5 years, that is by 2021, just after the next Olympic Games in Tokyo, so not that far away, we would have one certified teacher for every one of our 9,000 Australian schools. In 10 years, we could have a small team of certified teachers in every school. I think that's pretty impressive, and I think it's actually very possible. So tomorrow, some of you will be collaborating to develop plans along with Professor Hattie and Dr. Yong Zhao, focused on certification to address this. So, and I, you know, really look forward to learning from the expertise in the room and working with you to develop those plans. Others of you will have a chance to work on our second focus, the induction of new teachers to the profession. It's no coincidence that AITSL's been undertaking research into how best we support early careers teachers for the last 18 months, and that induction was a focus of the report last year by the Teacher Education Ministerial Advisory Group, TMAG. In the coming months, AITSL will publish induction guidelines that we hope will address the problem. A problem that, according to a parliamentary inquiry into teacher education in 2007, results in up to 25% of new teachers leaving teaching within the first 5 years. So this focus is about the newest members of our profession who yet to fully reach their potential, and as experienced teachers, we all know in those first years we asked a lot of questions. We questioned whether we were making a difference, how to be better, whether we were right for the job. We wonder what good teaching looks like. This graphic that was published a couple of weeks ago by the Schools Network in the UK shows the new teacher as a receiver, a consumer of knowledge. And it really, I think, highlights the role and importance of practice-focused support for those who are new to our profession. As the prominent American mythologist Joseph John Campbell pointed out in his Hero of a Thousand Faces, every hero's journey is supported by a mentor figure. How could Daniel LaRusso ever have become the karate kid without Mr. Miyagi teaching him the core concepts of wax on, wax off? Or Luke Skywalker without Yoda to tell him do or do not? There is no try. So I acknowledge that as certified teachers and leaders in your schools, you're already working to develop the expertise of your colleagues, either formally or informally, by mentoring and coaching them. And it's this experience that we hope to draw on as we develop action plans on induction tomorrow. In addition, my colleagues at AITSL are developing a bank of questions and an induction app, and we'll come back to you outside this forum as network members to seek your input on those. We'll also be seeking your help in developing masterclasses, and we want to use those to try to make more explicit the expertise of highly accomplished and lead teachers. And tomorrow again, some of you will have the opportunity to help us prototype this resource. So let me conclude by saying, I believe that the network can be a force of positive change within Australian education. I see us looking back on today in 5 years or so and seeing this moment as a real milestone. You are excellent teachers and pioneers of this movement, and the success will depend on the spirit and dedication of each of us. I encourage you throughout the summit to think about what role you can play to help drive professional experience through the network and the personal and collective commitment you'll leave with at the end of tomorrow as champions of the network and leaders of our profession. Now, there's another leader you've been waiting to hear from. The Federal Education Minister, the Honourable Simon Birmingham, was appointed to his current role in September 2015 and has served as a Liberal Party Senator in South Australia since 2007. The Minister has shown great support for AITSL and for this network, and I'm sure will be very interested to follow the excellent work that you continue to do. It's a privilege for me to hand over to the Minister.